Ladies and gentlemen, whether you like it or not,
greetings, gentle viewers. Welcome to the fourth and final part of the Apocalypse Quadrilogy.
Will the story come to a conclusion? Will they witness the downfall of the Antichrist? The return of Christ in all of his face-melting glory?
In a word, no.
In two words, fuck no. I don't know if they wanted to make more films after this, but this film leaves the situation pretty much as it was at the end of the rest of the films. The Antichrist has suffered a small defeat, and the Christian recurring cast are out there doing stuff. Since these films are set at three-month intervals, I'm guessing we would have needed something like 28 more films to get to the end of the tribulation period. So at least the sane part of my brain is happy they gave up after four. Of course, a fifth has been mooted for years, and if it happens, I will review it. But anyway, onto judgment. Forget all you think you know about the end of tribulation, because Helen Hanna is not dead. Under execution, which was mentioned by the guy who was undercover with the bad guys,
Helen Hanna's dead.
Didn't actually happen, and since she spends the first few seconds of this film dreaming about her execution, I'm going to assume that the whole end of Tribulation was a dream. That Gary Busey and Howie Mandel were captured and VR helmeted and later killed Busey's wife before running off to Minsk together and raising polar bears. Why?
Because, as far as I'm concerned, it made more sense than what actually happened.
Especially considering Busey, his wife, and Howie might as well not exist anymore. Unlike Jeff Fahey, they don't even get a mention. They're just gone. But my version has sort of a problem because the Antichrist has yet again completely changed his look. Yeah, it's the same actor three times in a row, but it's like the guy arrived on set, made up for a different film, and every time they just went with it.
It's a pity he wasn't in a Star Trek movie.
So, where was I? Oh yeah, the Antichrist, completely different look again. With the ending of Tribulation as is, he could have been trying a weird spin doctor thing, like trying a less obviously evil image to make the people love him again after admitting that they're all going to burn in hell because of him. Now, the biggest change between this film and the others actually is that they have sort of begun attempting to use science fiction sets at least part of the time. The Antichrist talking to this evil lawyer woman. He's angry about the people hating him because of the whole having his plan announced on TV to the world thing. It turns out that recently there's been a lack of Christians being turned over to the authorities. Instead of just concluding that there might have been less of them around, he instead quotes Karl Rove.
It is time to awaken some good old-fashioned bitterness among the citizens of this world. I want everyone on one side.
Does he have a fish tank for a desk?
I want everyone on one side.
Maybe. Anyway, the Antichrist announces that he's going to put Helen Hanna on trial to show off how much better he is than God. However, the evil lawyer woman apparently saw the end of the last film.
I thought that she was already
dead. So did she.
And you know right off the bat that the concept for this is stupid. A woman that you claim to have executed months ago reappears for a show trial. How will you get your people to trust you again by demonstrating that you just lied to them? Imagine if just before the election, Obama announced that they didn't actually kill Bin Laden, but they're gonna put him on trial. Yeah, he has mind control powers, but he has mind control powers. Why is this even a problem? He can mind control people into thinking and doing what he wants. So, evil lawyer woman goes to meet our actual actor of the film, Corbin Bernstein.
AKA a guy who's only entertaining when he's tearing idiots' teeth out.
He's going to be Helen Hanna's defender, and evil lawyer woman's going to be the prosecutor. Corbin's a conflicted guy, taking the mark but yet doesn't hate Christians. He's mostly decent but has a dark past and tries to do what's right, and yet he's not a Christian. In most films, that'd be pretty usual, but for these films, which do everything in their power to make the different sides as obvious as possible, barring actually color-coding characters, it's frankly amazing to see a main character who's actually a bit grey. But this, of course, fucks up one of the series' central ideas, i.e. anyone who's taken the mark is irredeemably evil, partly because it wouldn't sit well with the audience to see a lot of clearly good people who are going to be tortured. So which is it? Did the film fuck up its own continuity and the beliefs of the makers by having a good man who took the mark? Or has he got no mark and they're just ignoring little things like, how the fuck does the Antichrist not know that this guy, who's lawyering in his case, doesn't have the mark of the beast? He meets every single person as they get the mark. He knows them all by name.
I'm going to go with he has no mark. Corbin Bernstein has no mark.
Hey, movie, how come the Antichrist is okay with this guy who has no mark being a lawyer at his trial? Unless the cyber Antichrist that we see in the VR simulation isn't actually the Antichrist, but is actually part of a computer program, okay? Then how is it doing magic? And how come its database can't be accessed and checked? And oh, fuck it, this is turning into Law and Order bone kickers. Anyway, Corbin doesn't want the job because he's conflicted and has to be dragged by the prosecutor to judge not Michael Berryman to be convinced to take the job. I don't know shit about law, but I'm pretty sure this isn't how it's done. Also, this is 9 months after the rapture. When did you get time to rewrite the entire legal code so it's about as fair as that of Cardassia?
You've scripted this entire trial?
Today, the world watches as the biggest trial in history begins. Hater Helen Hanna has formally been charged with hatred of the human race.
Again, no one comments on the enemy of the state turning up 3 months after execution for a show trial! Fucking idiots. Deserves to be mind-controlled.
At the Christian's latest genius hideout, they're watching the live news. The whole gang's here. Native American guy, second most important recurring character in the films, and of course, the most distraught, Mr. T and his wife.
I can't imagine what she must be going through.
I can't imagine that I was originally written to be Gary Busey's wife.
No, sweetheart. God help those who help themselves.
I'm afraid I'm going to have to drown Mr. T's rising speech for a moment to tell you that God helps those who help themselves wasn't actually in the Bible. No matter what religious social Darwinists would like you to think. Mr. T decides that they need to turn terrorist and strike hard and fast and get Helen Hanna out of there. This might have worked if it had been Gary Busey's character who he knew was a cop, but no. And T doesn't even know what part of the Bible the Christians are supposed to listen to.
Black eye for black eye, broken tooth for broken tooth.
If a man slaps you, let him slap you 77 times. If he does it again, break his face!
Mr. T decides to act, but is held back by everyone else. His character is called JT, which tells me they couldn't actually be bothered to think of a name for him. A couple of times, other people just call him T. That's a special mix of lazy and another type of lazy. So in her cell, that's not actually connected to the ground, Helen Hanna waits and has her first meeting with Corbin Bernstein. He explains her crime is the worst possible under the legal system that they spent weeks drawing up. Hatred of humanity. Whatever that means. Oh, and courts are now inside panopticons, because that clearly makes them more fair. Or perhaps the designers were just trying to invoke people's natural fear of Star Trek VI. On the way in, Helen Hanna sets off a no-mark detector, because they've been invented.
Hey, how did Corbin Bernstein get in without setting it off?
The case begins, and the evil lawyer woman, whose surname is actually Thorne, in a dazzlingly subtle reference to The Omen, gives the crux of the prosecution, which is basically this. Christians think we're evil, therefore they need to die. And to explain this, she uses a paddle, because Earth is a boat, and if the Christians don't die, it's going to go over a waterfall or something. In a brief recess, Corbin has a talk with Hanna back at her cell. Well, it's not really a talk, more some not very well acted yelling about God.
Please, if you want to die, that's fine, but do not lecture me about your suicide cult. And any god that demands that kind of loyalty is a menace.
Oh, wait, I do that.
Back at the trial, Corbin shows that two can play insane games when he starts using the paddle and boat analogy himself, and finally just decides to put God on trial.
Let's put her master on trial. Order! Let's put Helen Hanna's God on trial.
Hear that? That's the sound of legal proceedings being raped and liking it.
Lucky for Corbin, the Antichrist just so happened to be on his way to a wedding and dropped by to agree that God should be put on trial.
Your zeal becomes you, Mitch.
I can read minds, and I don't give a shit that you have no mark. I, too, can move in mysterious ways.
So they go ahead and change the trial midway through. Some people go walking through the set of Welcome to Paradox, and if you get that reference, get out more often. And the news of the new trial against God gets Mr. T so riled up that he decides to act. Again!
Now, if they won't find brimstone, then they gonna get it.
And even though he's pretty fucking distinctive as he is, he goes off with his cross over his t-shirt.
He might as well wander around Nazi Germany in a skull cap and a t-shirt that says, I'm circumcised, ask me how.
He gets a fake Mark of the Beast from Jamie Heineman from Mythbusters, who then hacks into the network and registers him as having a mark. Yes, this is probably how Corbin Bernstein got his, but I say again, the Antichrist got magic. You can't hack magic. Well, maybe you can if you're both Mythbusters guys, but not with only one. Across town, Corbin Bernstein is hanging around a church and remembering his father being put on trial for being a Christian. And as soon as he leaves, we discover that not Anton LaVey has returned from explosion-related death to use a flare gun to destroy the church.
I've seen Canadians return from the dead for stupider reasons.
I heard that.
You read it. I sent you the script.
Touché.
I'm a little amazed it's taken them this long to burn the place down. They're treating the whole Christian religion like Al-Qaeda. It's not like the USA would leave the Ayman al-Zawahiri Outdoors Activity Center intact years after 9/11 without at least a change of the name. Mr. T has met up with two young homeless people who refuse to take the mark and enlist them in his mission to save Helen Hanna. He enlists the first two people he finds. Him with his visible cross. If he's not indestructible, I can see no reason why he's not dead yet. Meanwhile, in Corbin's penthouse of penthouse, the Antichrist has teleported in, threatens him, and demonstrates his mind-reading ability by talking about Corbin's alcoholism. Mind-reading abilities which don't quite stretch as far as to find out if he has the fucking mark.
Rooting around your mind for embarrassing secrets, but discovering if you're disloyal? That's just rude!
So Corbin goes to see Helen Hanna, using a scrambling device so no one can watch or listen to them. But wouldn't the guards just come in to make sure the camera's not broken? She is the world's most high-profile prisoner after all, or they're just gonna sit there in their room. Okay. Why isn't there a guard in her cell with her anyway? I really don't think the Antichrist would give much of a shit about her personal space. They yell at each other, plead with each other, and finally the conversation turns to Corbin's Mark of the Beast.
Senator Vrenak, what's your take?
It's a fake!
Captain Sisko, your rebuttal?
And it's real!
Vrenak, rebuttal?
It's a fake!
Sisko, last word.
Don't you understand? It is real!
Now, we obviously have no consensus on.
It's a fake! It's real!
Oh! Minion, come here.
Take this. Kill them both. I want a fictional fucking character from the far future interrupting my fucking review show!
Yes, color me massively fucking surprised that it's actually a fake Mark of the Beast. Corbin has some severe issues with his father, who died because he converted to Christianity after the rise of the Antichrist.
I don't need my father scratched. I watched. I saw what it cost him. I'm not gonna stick my neck out for some god who turns his back on the world and forces a father to abandon his son.
Dude, you're in your late 40s. You weren't abandoned. Get over it!
Of course, I wonder why he felt okay enough to reveal that his mark was fake. I mean, for all he knows, she could have told the guards and brought him down with her. They could have fixed the camera. Someone could have overheard them. Anyway, back at the trial, and a general isn't familiar with the term common era.
It was a so-called Christian era.
The whole trial is stupendously badly done. If the Antichrist really wanted to put God on trial, then there's something very simple he could start off with, and it's never even touched on here. Genocide. It happens a lot in the Bible, and it's always either caused by or instigated by God. But no, that would require the audience to think, and that can't be allowed. But at least, hey, it's Willy from Revelation, being living proof that taking the Mark of the Beast makes you 13% gayer looking.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth for the unity of all people?
Sure thing, handsome.
That was a joke. I didn't expect proof.
The trial from this point goes from very stupid to amazingly stupid because they announce openly that Michael Lusso is the Antichrist, that he is the devil. Apparently, they gave up hiding that at some point, but let's gloss over that weird fact with this.
Check this out.
Well then, case closed. Bang! God's clearly guilty.
Their entire argument against God is basically this. Michael Lusso is the Antichrist, and the Antichrist is the devil, and he rocks, and God sucks because the devil gives people psychic powers. And back at the Christian's hideout, they have a working security system this time. Great! How did they buy it? No one can buy or sell unless they have the mark. It's a minor plot point in the two people that Mr. T enlisted story. The same people who just came back to their base with him. So finally, Mr. T decides to act. Once more.
If those 666ers are set on going to hell, I say why can't we help send them there?
And he seems to have stolen a gun belonging to Angry Joe. Finally, Helen Hanna takes to the stand. It's the trial of the century. It's the world's most infamous woman. It's the things that great legal dramas are made of. And unfortunately, it's pretty much as shit as the rest of the film.
The rest of the world is all paddling in one direction.
And we're back to the fucking paddles.
Row, row, row your boat.
gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 lightly down the stream. Merrily, 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 merrily.
Misled, selfish, and prejudiced. That is what Miss Hannah is.
So are you.
I call to the stand Jesus Christ.
Oh, wait, no. Hold on. Hi. Sorry I was late. I'm here.
Prosecution knows that the witness cannot possibly come to the stand.
No, I can. I mean, yeah, I was dead for a while, but I'm better now.
Admit that he can't be put on trial because he's intangible.
Hey, if you're saying what I think you're saying, it was only the one time.
Impotent.
I knew it.
If this trial is going to be about him, where is he?
Right here, getting insulted by a lawyer.
Son of God! Come, defend yourself!
You know what? Fuck it. I've got a wall in Mexico I could be appearing on.
Make us believers or concede defeat. Your God is either a coward or a fraud.
Hold me back, Peter. Hold me back! Thomas, do not doubt that I will kick your ass if you don't get me my Glock.
Or maybe just a good bedtime story.
You do realize that your entire case rests on the devil giving you powers? The same devil that wouldn't exist if there was no God? Just saying!
Our God is here today. So for my last witness, Your Honor, I call to the stand the only and real savior of humanity, Franco Macaluso.
Who, by their own argument, can't exist. Just saying!
Lucifer, do you exist?
Do I exist? Touch my hand. Come on, feel my flesh. Am I real?
Yes, indeed.
So at least part of her argument against God is automatically void. Just saying!
The Antichrist talks and talks and talks, and the people cheer and everyone declares him to be better than God. And to be honest, when compared to the God as portrayed in this universe, he is better. He doesn't actually send anyone to hell. That's on God. Of course, that doesn't fix the problem that without God, this guy, the devil, can't exist. So their argument that God doesn't exist is fucking broken! Anyway, Corbin Bernstein goes to visit the Christians, even though they're wanted felons, and he's not even followed, even though not Anton LaVey was standing outside his window looking ominous. He wants some proof that the Christians aren't behind the bombing, so they provide him with some explosives equipment they have.
If you want my help, I'm gonna need some evidence. I need something like that detonator the Swag was holding in the videotape.
That's not a problem. We got that. We got a lot of other stuff, too.
Having explosives. Proving people innocent of terrorism since whenever this was made.
So just as Corbin leaves, right about the time when the bad guys should be invading and killing them all, Mr. T decides to act. For the fourth time. Luckily for us, he doesn't get to do it a fifth time because the bad guys receive their cue and finally attack.
The good guys dress in black, remember that. Just in case we ever face to face and make contact. The title held by me, MIB, means what you think you saw, you did not see. So don't blink, be what was dead is now. Go on black suit with the black ray bands on. Walk in shadow, move the silence. Guard against extraterrestrial violence. But yo, we ain't on no government list. We straight, don't exist, no names and no fingerprints. Saw some strange watch your back, cause you never quite know where the MIBs is at.
So, the second most important character of the series, whatever she's called, barely escaped the attack and managed to walk right into the court at the center of the Antichrist's headquarters. Without a mark, while being a wanted fugitive whose image they have on file since the last time they arrested her in Revelation. And their version of the Bible looks a lot like the traditional Torah.
Huh. Weird, and possibly a bit anti-Semitic.
So why'd she do that? Simple, it gave her something to do. So somehow she's allowed to testify, without having the VR helmet that'd either kill her or convert her placed in her head. And then they're talking about God.
Why didn't your God appear in court when called?
God is not commanded by the wills of men.
Ah, but Macaluso. He was here.
And God is right here.
But he could have defended himself. He could have saved his followers.
He could have come down from the cross, too, when they mocked him. His ways are not our ways.
God's ways are mysterious and lazy.
In the next little bit, they attempt to legally prove the resurrection of Jesus by mentioning Simon Greenleaf, a 19th century Christian apologist and lawyer who thought it really happened. I don't really know if the court here ever decides if the resurrection really happened or not. I was far too busy being amazed that, unlike Tribulation, they actually name-dropped a real person. Tribulation, you see, had mentioned a doctor who had done research into morphic fields as a way to set up the whole morphic fields Antichrist powers thing.
Have you ever heard of Dr. Emeril Fugimoto?
No.
That guy doesn't exist. When I Google searched him, the first thing that came up was that line in a digitized copy of the film's novel adaption. But yeah, Simon Greenleaf was a real guy.
Though I have to say, a Christian apologist is hardly going to be impartial, and we expect honesty from a lawyer, for God's sake! You're gonna have to be harder than that when we face the Supreme Court next week!
Corbin uses his disruptor MacGuffin again and screams about his father like a teenager pitching a fit. Of course, the camera feed gets fixed in time for the opposing lawyer to order the police to search him, and I'm not really sure how that works. Now that Mr. T has proved his indestructibility by surviving being blown up by a grenade, he leads his strike team into the court. His strike team consisting of the guy he enlisted off the streets who's not a Christian.
I'm so glad that I thought of sending the non-believer in there alone.
Ah, pity the fool who don't think it was a good idea.
Oh good, he's done. Hopefully they'll just kill him and save us the bother.
Look, he's dead and he's gonna go to hell, bringing our grand total of good non-Christians who died to 2 black guys. Draw your own conclusions.
Though I have to wonder why they killed the guy. He was dressed in one of their uniforms. Shouldn't they have at least asked a couple of questions first? So we discover the Antichrist's official title is Chancellor. How evil, and European, and Klingon, when they call him to the stand again and he arrives amid cheers and invisible falling rose petals. Corbin's questioning gets Helen so riled up that she's dragged away to be kept with the other Christian woman, and Corbin begins his final demonstration, which will signify something.
Your Honor, I'd like to call one final witness. I would like to call anyone to the stand who is willing to die for Lucifer.
I wonder if anyone tried this in Nuremberg.
The point of this is that since no one will die for the Antichrist, therefore God is right and the Antichrist is evil. Oh, this is so stupid. Allow me to count some of the ways. 1. People die for wrong things all the time. 2. Something is not decided to be right because people will die for it. 3. He has mind control powers. He could control anyone to take the bullet for him. 4. He could probably melt the bullet. 5. Would a bullet even kill this guy? He's the devil! And of course, I think the people of the island of Tanna who worship Prince Philip might take exception to the idea that any god who can be killed by a bullet isn't that much of a god.
But I wouldn't. Killed by a bullet? That's just shit! Oh, wait.
And while all this was going on, Mr. T, regulation haircut or no regulation haircut, walked into the jail cell and scared the guard into leaving.
Do I look patient?
Of course, that doesn't stop Tony Todd from interrupting.
What department are you with?
This is an important announcement. There is a sale on lingerie at Macy's.
And not giving that much of a shit about his job, really. So Helen Hanna and the others escape. Corbin is gunned down, and it's the end. Unless they get around to making that fifth film.
Well, you finally chose a side. You take a bullet for your new god.
This was bad. Shocking, I know. It did for the courtroom what Bone Kickers did for archaeology, and gave its ethically bankrupt theology the propaganda it deserved. Shit propaganda! The directing was bad, the actors awful, the script was more like a collection of clichés attached by stage directions. These films are all a mix of shit and funny. Some are more just shit like Revelation, and some are more shit and funny like Apocalypse. That film could get a room-like following if you showed it to the right people and the right substances. Watch these if you want to laugh. If you want a good film about Christianity, then check out Pasolini's Gospel According to St. Matthew or The Last Temptation of Christ. If you want a good Rapture movie that has very little to do with the actual Rapture theology, then watch The Rapture starring Mimi Rogers. If you want a funny-as-fuck Rapture movie, then watch Megiddo The Omega Code 2. And if you want to get converted, then watch something else and get your head examined for wanting to watch a film to convert you to something. I'm not finished with The Rapture or religious movies in general, but it's going to be a little while before I do any more. Why? Variety. And partway through Revelation, I really felt like a bully kicking the head of a kid in a helmet. These films are stupid and awful, and awfully stupid, and doing all four of these in quick succession really took it out of me.
I'm Demanda Hagen, and I'm going on holiday. Fuck you all!
Fucking come on, you pretty little face, you stinking pink bitch, and you'll fucking like it!